Oh, great start.
I hate you so much. You ruin everything. You know, when I made this, I thought maybe I should not unmute everyone at the same time, but I did, and I got one of those right here, Chris. I'm also
champion. That's why I brought mine up.
Folks.
No, it's just funny because we can't hear the music, so it's doing weird things while it's going.
Why can't you hear them? You can hear the music.
I heard it like kick on, and yeah, when you talk, it is condensing the audio down to like mono for some reason.
You know,
weird.
usually I turn off the stuff, and I didn't. Anyways, folks, welcome to Local Chat. It's episode 65, I think. Ian's here.
Wow.
Chris is here.
Yeah, actually, I did see that it was 65 earlier, and I was like, what the fuck? It's been over a year. How many times have I been on this, like, 12 times and not even noticed it?
Too many times. No, I'm just kidding. Always a pleasure to have you back.
Oh, I'll leave right now. I'll go straight to sleep. I'll go play Guilty Gear.
I feel like, weren't you on the first episode?
I was.
It's wild that we have less viewers than we did when we started.
Ian, does it warm the sub cockles of your heart that's still on my desk? Months after me.
I think it's just a nice Chris is holding up the minigame game show notes that I print out for myself, and I mail that with the prize to the winner. I feel like that's such a nice touch, little souvenir from the show.
I was gonna get mine framed, and then I realized I didn't care that much. If I ever happen upon it, I mean, it would fit in like a regular little shitty photo frame because it's what, 4x6,
yeah,
just, right?
Literally, go to the Dollar Tree. They got crappy.
Actually,
frames.
I think I have those in the other room.
All right, so
one of you guys is talking. I'll go do it. It is episode 65. It is, what is today even? It's almost April. Today's the end of March 31st.
Tomorrow's the worst day.
Worst day. It's also really annoying because all of my, like, work meetings for the month of April were this week, even though it's not April till Friday. So it was just like, here we go.
What?
Well, because like
that
content,
just sounds like
content.
Oh,
prep.
You mean planning. I thought you meant you had like recurring monthly meetings, and those for April fell on the 31st because somebody's bad at setting up Outlook reoccurrences.
I was actually really excited. I was telling Karen about this. I finally figured out Outlook. Because I had never used it before. When Chris and I worked together at Reward the Fan, we had Outlook, but it was just like I would get an email or two occasionally to send files to each other. But like now I have to like keep track of meetings and do like Zoom meetings and set up stuff. So I finally got two calendars to like overlay on top of each other.
Oh, it's great, isn't it?
Oh, so
that's the good stuff.
Before, I would have to have the side-by-side calendars and check, because one calendar was PTO. And the other one was like my daily schedule, and there's literally one button you just click and it puts the calendars together. And I was like, so pissed off.
You guys have a PTO calendar? How does that work? Like if you're going on PTO, you put it on that calendar?
Yeah.
That's smart.
It hasn't come up that often, but literally like my team has maybe six or seven people on it that work day to day together. And I think four of them are gone next week. So it's like two video producers and one social person is on for like Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. So it's like, oh God. But honestly, this is getting in the weeds, but we have like everything planned out. And I'm here, but I'm doing the daily news stuff. I'm not like doing big projects because everyone planned out content, which is really nice.
That's nice.
Yeah, so that's nice. Anyways, we're here to talk about video games and video game news. Before we get to the news, we got to talk about what we've been playing. I got a new monitor, and so I don't know where to put things now because it's a different shape.
I don't know how to feel.
And I got to like put things. I got a 1440 by 2560 monitor, and it's physically smaller than my ultra wide, but it's the same resolution. And I put them above each other, and now my camera's here, and it's just like, it was like...
Well, Willie is stacking things. Hey, Ian, real fast. Those, what are those bins behind you? On
these
your shelving?
Bins?
Yeah.
Those are from IKEA. I just finished, so I had consoles.
Okay, hold on. That's great. I do, before we get... Turn your head a little bit the opposite direction, like keep spinning the way you're going. Is that a box of pasta? The blue one. The blue one.
No,
is that a box?
Pikachu.
Of
pasta?
That's a Pikachu N64. A box of pasta.
I thought it was a box of Berea or yes. Barilla. I'm not trying to say it. Pasta.
I can see that.
That's all the only reason I asked about the bins, because yeah. I was like, you just have pasta behind you, and if so, why?
I need to get a little bit more light. Yeah, the problem with moving and owning a house is that I realized we have like 12 projects that we started and we have not finished any of them. So this past weekend, I was like, I'm going to pick a project and I'm going to finish it. And this one was finally going to IKEA, getting these bins, getting some acrylic sheets from Lowe's, using a heat gun to bend them into specific shape holders. So basically, I have the consoles on the front of these bins now, and then you pull out the bin and it has the controllers and the power cords inside. That's it, cool. Which is pretty nice. Yeah, I need to get a little bit more lighting, like spot lighting almost on them, mm-hmm. so they pop a little bit more. But I'm happy with it. It's a nice little display storage thing. Except I've got this blank one here because that's where the PS4 goes, because I'm playing so stupid Kingdom of Hearts right now.
I've had the idea for a while now to get like a wall, like basically behind me in whatever place I move to next, and cover it with keycaps and switches, but no actual boards. So the whole wall is like just a huge thing of keys.
Ooh,
that's pretty
cool.
You could
totally do that cheap if you buy one of those like pallets of keyboards. That's from, like, well,
I was thinking just like an office liquidation.
Yep, exactly. Yeah.
And then just break the keys off.
I may steal that. Just letting you know.
Let's talk about video games. What have we been playing, Will?
We've been playing video games. I'll start with me quick because I don't have a huge list like you two butts. I am still playing Elden Ring. I took a break from it for a while, and I took a break from like most video games because I was like watching TV or working on my models. And when I was playing video games, it was like Picross on the 3DS.
Let's go,
which is great. Yeah. I've almost finished Picross. It's like Picross E8 or whatever. I don't know if it's like Edition 8 or whatever. But I've gotten to the 20x15 puzzles, and those are super fun.
Hey, I've been just real quick. I ran out of Picross games on my, I don't want to say ran out on my mobile, but I had a couple that I was playing and I kind of maxed them out almost. What's the one you're playing now on 3DS? And is that good? Should I install it and start playing it?
Yeah, it's I think it's just Picross. It's like something Picross, but they're the ones who make like the 3D one. I played a little bit of the 3D one and like I know people rave about it and I can see how cool it is. But I played through the tutorial and then went back to it, and I was just like, I just want to play normal nonogram Picross. Yeah.
You guys want me to fuck you up with what you should be playing Picross-wise?
Uh-oh.
What's that? What?
Just send it in the Discord for you both.
You did send it.
Just go ahead and pop that open.
Oh, no.
Let me just open this. What? My Nintendo Picross? Oh, I have heard good things about that.
My Nintendo Picross, The Legend of Zelda Twilight Princess. Oh, how the fuck did these cowards not call it The Legend of Zelda Twilight Picross? Come on!
Oh, that is pretty good. But branding, but yes.
Yeah, but the answer good. Is Miyamoto and Aonuma said, I'll kill you.
I'm pretty sure this is on my shelf, so I need to put this in my 3DS. Man, I should do that. That sounds really cool. I have the Pokemon Picross, which is pretty neat because you like use the Pokemon in your party's powers to like do stuff.
That's fun. That's
which
cool.
is kind of cool. And then this is on your Nintendo Switch, but the Japanese only release of Super Mario Picross is on the SNES games on the Switch. That's pretty cool. Fun. That one actually has a really cool one. Like when you break the blocks, it like does a little hammer that like smashes everything.
Oh, that's fun.
I've genuinely enjoyed that.
What does that have to do with Elden Ring?
Not much. I was just thinking of how little video games I played. Ring, I've explored, I think, all of the map. I'm at one of the final areas. I'm just a little underleveled because I wouldn't say I was rushing through stuff, but I was like going back and exploring older areas and leveling up, and then I like rammed forward after that. Mm-hmm. So I'm towards the end area now and kind of playing through that. But I think I'm going to go back and fill out, like, my process has been like, do an area, go forward one area, and then go back two areas and like fully explore that area.
Yeah.
I think we talked about this like last week.
One of the biggest things I'm encountering with this game is like bursts of progress, where it's like I'll fuck around and go around the map and explore a bunch of shit, and not like get anything really done, but I'm like, I'm exploring, I'm finding different chunks of the, like the map pieces, I'm finding upgrades and Titanite chunks. I'm not calling them spinning sounds, fuck off. And then like I'll be like, oh yeah, this is like a video game, and then I'll go do actual progression and like fight like four of the bosses I'm supposed to be fighting, and then go back to fucking around. And like it's not unsatisfying, but it almost makes it feel like sometimes I'm like, I'm having more fun fucking around than I am actually playing the video game, which is still playing the video game. But I think that's not a problem, but I think it is something that'll be interesting to see how Miyazaki and his team like figure that out going forward. I cannot imagine they go back to a non-open world format after this, just because of like, you know, the mountain of money that just got dumped on top of them. But you never know.
Or I can't see them going back to a pure linear. Like, I can see them having another Dark Souls, but with more options.
That's the thing that I enjoy most about this. Like, the open world nature is cool, and I love jumping around on a double-running horse, because who doesn't? But, like, yeah, the fact that I don't, like, if I am up against a wall that, like, I can't do right now, I could just go somewhere else, and God, that is just such a, like, a... It makes me so much more, like, willing to sit down and play the game, because I'm not, like...
Yeah, because, like, I know Ian's made fun of me for this wrongly, I'll say, but, like... The thing you would do with Dark Souls is you would hit yourself against a wall 10 times, then you would get a bunch of souls, and then on your way back to turn in those souls, you would die, then you would respawn, you would die again, so you'd lose all those souls, and then you'd say, fuck it, you'd walk to the boss, you'd summon two people, and then you'd have those two people fight the boss with you, and you'd beat the person instead of, like, overcoming that obstacle yourself. So that's, like, half my mindset with this still is, like I mentioned previous weeks, those first two bosses, I was like, I have to beat these bosses. I've tried 10 times, now it's the time to summon. And like after those, I made a point of being like, oh, that's not how Elden Ring's played. I don't need to do that. So all the next bosses, I didn't summon people for, because it's like, I can get there myself, because that's what they've done with this game.
Yeah, and I mean, I am fake busting your balls a little bit, but yeah, totally. I'm not a big fan of summoning other people to help with boss fights in Elden Ring, because the game gives you so many other, I would argue, better ways to cheese the game. And so for me, it's kind of like summoning other people to do it for you is stepping outside the game a little bit. That is a very subjective opinion, but there's better ways to cheese it.
And actually, I will say, Dark Souls, before they were, I guess, super popular, like Elden Ring is, you wouldn't summon people and they would just beat the boss for you. Like, that's not how it works. Like, A, summoners do less damage anyways, and B, those people are always there to, like, help you. And, like, I had a couple stuff with Dark Souls 1 where it's like, I summon a guy, I died, and then the person messaged me, like, hey, do this, summon me again. Oh, that's cool. Like, that sort of stuff is how I've done Dark Souls. Mm-hmm. So, that one story I told last week is someone showing up and literally just killing the boss before I could reach it. That's the first time it's ever happened to me, and it makes sense that it's happened to me now, because there's people playing the game who are at that point and coming backwards, and I think by the time I got to other Souls games, those people had stopped playing the game. So it's neat to have that, but I totally agree, like, at this point with that game, it's such a luck of the draw when you're summoning people, because some of those people are there to help you, and then others of those people are there to make a YouTube video and be like, oh, check out how I killed this boss in one hit by being summoned. But yeah, I'm really enjoying the game. I think I'm almost 70 hours in. I'm level 99. Nice. I think I'm probably nearing the end, if not the actual end of the game, the end of me playing Elden Ring for at least a little bit, because I kind of want to move on. But yeah, that's mostly what I've been playing.
I'm 21 hours in.
Wow. You're on PC?
Yeah, I actually did. I do have it on both because I'm an absolute monster. I played probably about 5 to 10 hours on the PS5 and then decided it'd be more convenient if I had this at my desk, so I have it at my desk now, because I can't be playing Elden Ring at 3 o'clock in the morning in the living room next to the bedroom.
Smart, very smart. Yeah. And Ian, you've stopped playing, or are you?
Yeah, it's kind of funny. I was playing up until last week's episode of Local Chat, and I kind of discussed that this was just, I forgot how I put it, but basically this was a game I was playing because I didn't have anything else to play. It was a good time waster. And I was waiting for more enthralling, exciting stuff to grab me. And it did. And we'll get to it, but I'm not playing any more Elden Ring.
This game is kind of, one thing blowing my mind, and then we're talking about Elden Ring, because it's been talked to death on every platform ever. This is the best game I've ever played that I don't care if I finish it. Like Souls 1 and 2, I was like, gotta finish these games. Bloodborne, platinum. It's my favorite, one of my favorite games of all time. I hate DS3, we won't get into that. Elden Ring, like, this is a fucking masterpiece. This is a great game. And I'm like, I might not finish this, and I don't give a shit.
You know, honestly,
I don't know what's up with that, but it's weird.
That played a role in me not wanting to continue to play the game. It was a very small part, but like, if I knew this game was 40 hours long and I probably have 15 hours in it, and I'm like, oh, I'm like 30-40% of the way through, I could probably finish this game. But knowing that I'm not, and that where I'm probably 10% of the way through, was just like, it, that honestly takes away some of the motivation. If you're not willing to commit fully, then it's like, well, I guess I'll keep playing, but there's not really that motivation to get to the end, because that is way too far away.
And Dark Souls for me, like, I've only beaten, Bloodborne's the only From Software game I've beaten. So, like, Dark Souls for me has always been like a, hey, I'm in the mood to play that type of game, and I'm going to choose one of them from the jackpot, or from the, whatever those are called, slot machine, there we go.
Pachinko.
To play, pachinko. So, like, I'm just, like, the time I just started playing Dark Souls 3 again, and it was just, like, hanging out with it, like, because you can just pick it up and go. And I think Elden Ring's the first time, which is kind of opposite of you guys, that I've been like, oh, I kind of want to get to the end of this and find out what happens, because I'm slightly paying attention to the story. And, like, not that I've known what has been happening this whole way, but I hit a story beat, and they were very clearly like, hey, you need to go to this area and get this thing to make this happen. And I was like, this is the most upfront any of these games has
ever
been.
I know, God.
So yes. I'm gonna go, I wanna go do that.
I don't know if the fact that, like, names of things makes, like there are named locations where they tell you to go and receive a named item and do a thing. I don't know if Martin has anything to do with that, but if that's what he did, God, that is the greatest gift to humanity this man could have done.
Yes. It's a step in the right direction.
Yeah. The amount of times people have been like, hey, you need to go get this, like, medallion. It's in this castle.
Yeah.
And, like, I'm counting my blessings. Like, I wish there was just a menu that told me all those things people told me, but I'm just counting the blessings that you've told me to do something in this game, and it's not an item description that I had to go hunt down.
that some asshole on YouTube had to make a fucking 26-minute video discussing how the translation change of this one word makes everything different.
Yeah,
it changes the whole game.
Oh, I can't talk about culturally Pokemon. Appropriated the samurai sword. Anyone else see that? Some YouTuber was like, "Oh, they culturally appropriated Japanese culture for the katana," and everyone's like, "You do know where these games are made, right?"
Oh, I'm sorry. They culturally appropriated Western culture for the medieval setting. Okay, now that is not as stupid.
Hidetaka Miyazaki, a white man.
Sounds
like a Jewish name to me. Hollywood.
Pokemon.
I played a little bit of Omega Ruby. I started on the 3DS. It's fun. And it's neat. And I remember a little bit of Ruby, and this is, like, way more of that. And it's also not a Game Boy, and it's got so many things going on. So I'll have more thoughts on that as I play next week. Also, my Analog Pocket came in. I've barely played with it today. It's in this box. I've kept it wrapped up and the plastic on it, because I'm afraid to touch it. but it's super cool. So I'll have more on this next week when I sit down with it a little bit longer.
Omega Ruby, Sapphire, too much water, yes or no? Kelly Flaggy?
Oh, that's the one? Oh,
that's the game, yeah.
Wait, what?
Kelly Flaggy, when they were at IGN, reviewed that game and said 7 out of 10, it has too much water in it.
Oh.
Like, that was like the review breakdown. And it's just like, okay.
Has the same amount of water as it did last time, what the fuck?
I just watched that video of the second version of a game. Of the guy trying to do the Cuphead tutorial.
Yes.
Isn't this that person who's like is somewhat actually respected as a nerd?
Isn't it Gene Park?
That's
no, it's
so
not Gene
funny.
Park. It's Dean Takahashi. something like
Takeshi. Yeah, I think you're right.
But like he's fine. Like I think what had happened is he's like distracted or something or wasn't paying attention. But someone put that video next to a pigeon intelligence test, and the pigeon finishes the test before he gets over the thing. So funny.
It's just one of those things where it's like you could totally do that. You could totally do that on the live stream. Lord knows I've done that kind of stupid stuff before.
Oh, totally.
But if it's an edited video that you are putting up and publishing, you don't think you want to be like, let's cut out this part where I look like an idiot for a couple minutes.
It's Dean Takahashi. And I do just want to know, you know how Google like auto generates questions you might have?
Yes.
Top one is Dean Takahashi real?
Well, is he?
Wow.
Oh my god.
Ian, please tell us about Kingdom Hearts 2.
I'll just touch on it real quick just to do a little bit of a plug. My time with Kingdom Hearts 2 is finally coming to an end. It's my understanding that I have less than 2 hours left in this game. I'm in the world that never was. Mm-hmm. I just got in there. I'm ready to finish it. Kingdom Hearts 2 is still a weird game. I personally am not a fan of it. I realized this today. I personally am not a fan of it. I don't think it's a good game, but I can totally 100% understand people who do think it's a good game and who love the game, because it is a very particular game for a very particular set of fan bases meshing together. And if I was in enough of those fan bases, I would love this game.
That's true. Are you not a Final Fantasy guy? I don't think I've ever talked about this with you.
Not really. I mean, I'm okay with JRPGs, but I'm not a huge JRPG guy. And I think some of the Final Fantasy stuff just gets into like bad, excessive anime storytelling tropes in a way.
That's Final Fantasy, baby.
And then like the Disney fandom where it's just like, oh my God, my favorite characters from my favorite cardboard thin Disney movie. And look at the setting. And so when you mesh all that together and you have a decent combat system and like a good JRPG, then yeah, if you're into those things, then hell yeah, it's an amazing game.
Yeah, but like you're like when Squall shows up, you don't like shit your pants because that wasn't like part of your childhood. Yeah.
Yeah, and so it's just one of those things where it's like, if the story beats in that game work for you, then hell yeah, it's amazing. But for me, it's not really working, and I'm not a member of those fan bases, so it's a borderline insufferable at parts.
I will accept all of these criticisms. I have to know one thing. Thoughts on the soundtrack?
It's very good.
Okay, it's very okay. Good. We're good. Thinking about we're it. Good. We're good. We're good. Fine.
A lot of it's simple actually very good. By Toad.
Maggie and I have started listening to Simple and Clean every time we get in the car.
So. It is like Hikaru Tada is an incredibly talented singer.
It's a great song.
Weird ass musician, but very talented.
So anyways, yeah, this Saturday, 8 p.m. Eastern is the end. I just want to say it's been a fantastic stream series. What a weird idea to force I don't want to say force myself, but I offered it up and then you all forced me to do it. And then to just be like, okay, well, let's make it obnoxious for me and to have Halucha and Elise and Will and everybody else who stops by just make it an enjoyable time. I really appreciate that. So another fantastic Subpixel series coming to an end this Saturday, 8 p.m. Eastern. I'm excited for it. Will, are you excited for me to stop streaming all the time now?
I do local chat for you because you need a place to talk about your terrible opinions. Well, you don't broadcast this anywhere. I don't know if you know that. It's just you shouting into a box.
What?
It's like Creed thoughts.
It's there's one RSS feed, and I'm the only subscriber. To
yeah.
Will actually has VHS tapes of this, and he keeps them. He mails them somewhere. I don't know where, but I know he takes them to the post office.
I mail them, and I just get a Morse code over my ham radio back, like the number stations. I am beyond excited to be able to stream normal content again. I was like thinking about it the other day. I was like, there's so many. I was like, oh, Karen and I should do like some Mario Party or like a game show. It's like,
yeah.
Use the time.
I can stream other games, but also the opposite, which is I'm playing Kingdom Hearts every Saturday and Tuesday. Wednesday is D&D. Thursday is local chat. So basically 4 nights of the week, I'm out of pocket, like 8 p.m. onwards. So it's really cutting into my gaming, relaxing time. So I'm glad to have that back. But that being said, one of the games that as soon as I started playing, I was like, wow, I would love to stream this.
I Googled this game when I saw it on the list. I was like, what the fuck is that? This is the most Ian Gibson-ass shit I've ever fucking seen. Please go on about Nebulous Fleet Commander.
It's a solid Ian game. Nebulous Fleet Command. I saw this. I saw a clip of Giant Bomb playing it, Matt Rory playing it, I believe, for an Unprofessional Friday. And literally, I was like, what is this? And I played like 5 seconds of the clip of him playing it. And I was like, okay, I'm going to go buy this immediately. And I went to Steam and I bought it. This came out in early access. It's $20. It is basically, it's kind of like Homeworld. It is a real-time strategy game, spaceships in a 3D space, so you're not stuck on a 2D plane. And it's also, it takes a lot of inspiration from The Expanse, mostly The Expanse TV show, especially in a lot of the presentation. Mm-hmm. But it's also very simmy, like a simulator, which is kind of weird because when you think about it, it's hard to do. It's not like a submarine simulator where you can look up documentation and interviews with submariners and be like, oh, this is how a submarine works. I can add all these details that are realistic. It's more like somebody was like, what if you took modern naval operations and how those are conducted and how those UIs look and merge them with some sci-fi from like The Expanse and then put that into a 3D spaceship space. And I mean, I was posting pictures in the Discord, y'all. Like literally 5 minutes into the tutorial, I was in love with this game. It just does some really cool stuff. Like basically the way it works is that you're really only in command of like two or three ships, typically like a couple frigates and corvettes. It's early access, so there's not a lot of content. So you really only have like missiles, guns, rail guns, and some lasers. And
they let corvettes in space.
Hey man, it's heavy metal. God bless that movie. Anyways, so you're you're controlling them through the space, but it's very it gives you a lot of hands-on control. So for example, you're not doing the typical RTS where you're like right click on a space to move them there or right click an enemy and they will auto attack. No, you have to give like specific commands. Like you open the movement button and there's like 7 different types of movement.
I'm out.
So there's like,
I'm out. Nope. I'm done.
It's so good.
I was like, maybe
this. Let me describe him though.
And then
let me
describe him.
This man is into this. This man who makes fun of every game for not.
Let me tell you why. Because you could just do a move position where you just say move here, right? And it's a pretty good UI. So you can be like, just move along this plane, or you just hold down control and you can be like, move, but, you know, adjust up, down. So move here, but also attitude up. But you can also do like orbit. Like, I want you to orbit this spaceship at 1500 meters. You can do formations. You can do headings. You can do roles. So, for example, one of the things I love to do is the game is all about radar. So, like, if I think the enemy is in that direction, but I haven't spotted them yet, I will move, but I will point my ship towards them. And it's because it gives me a smaller radar target. And it literally says that because you've selected the heading towards them. And then the other thing is, like, firing the weapons. It's not a right-click fire the weapons. It's like, no, I want you to use this specific ammunition. I want you to fire at this ship. Or when you do the missiles, you can say, I want you to fire at this missile. I want you to fire, you know, 3 missiles at this target. Or even crazier is they're basically like cruise missiles in space. So you can give them targets. So if you think somebody's hiding behind an asteroid, you set up waypoints so the missile goes around the asteroid and then it pops around the other side of the asteroid and then it's radar guided. So it'll lock onto a radar target. But then that enemy could set up the jammer and they could start the jammer. And the jammer is one of the craziest things ever. I know I'm going on about this game. I'll finish it at this. This is an example of like how cool this game is, the design and mechanics decisions they've created. So a lot of the game is you spotting an enemy on radar, or you firing like radar cruise missiles at them, or you trying to get a radar lock so your railgun is more accurate, right? But the enemy and you can use a jammer. If your ship has equipped with a jammer, then you can jam their radar for like 30 seconds. You know how it presents that? I'll start with the simple one. If you're jamming somebody, it just shows up as like a light red cone on the TAC map. Like you are jamming this direction, right? If you're getting jammed though, if okay, so the enemy shows up as these like red dots And the closer you are, you get more details. But typically it's just like, it's just like red reticle 8,000 meters, you know, something like that. If they start jamming you, your whole UI just starts dancing with all these dots. So it literally feels like you're being jammed. You're just like, I can't tell what are the real targets and what are not. I can't tell anything. But then you can, like, if you calm down, you look around, you go, oh, they're only jamming me from this direction. So even though I can't see them, I know they are over there somewhere. Like, just all the little mechanical and aesthetic decisions they made make this game so cool. It's an early access, so it doesn't have a lot in it, but man, it just feels, it feels so good.
There is a variety of game out there, and there are a lot of different games and different genres that fall under this. I always say Armored Core is one. This is a game for perverts. Armored Core is a game for mech perverts. This is a game for Starfleet Command, yeah, Navy perverts. Yes. The simple version of the movement you described, I didn't want to stop your train of thought, but I didn't want to hit. The simple movement had both moving in a direction, which I would call a simple movement, but apparently, fuck me. And then also, the concept of the Z-axis. That's not simple!
But the way they implement
it. Extra dimension! No, I get it, yeah.
Makes it, because that's very difficult. There's plenty of games that try and do 3D movement in an RTS that is just like, this interface sucks,
but the way
they do it is really nice.
3D movement as an interface thing is like one of the most difficult things to not make a fucking nightmare out of.
Yeah, I just wanted to mention, like they do have the pseudo easy options. It's not as easy as right click, but it's just like right click movement to this position. But they offer all those extra details. So if you want to get into the nitty gritty and be like, face this direction, roll this way, you can do that if you want to, but you don't have to, which is fantastic.
I will say this game does look really cool. It looks like Space Battleship Yamato, and also Battlestar
Galactica.
I do like
the UI.
It does look cool.
Yeah, it's great.
I will say the greatest thing that came out of that segment is David coming up with
radar and jam.
No, David coming up with the term infuriating, which I think is a great word to describe.
That's very good.
Ian. Save Data here says, I hate that Ian refuses to learn what the core mechanics in Kingdom Hearts 2, but will happily learn an esoteric space sim.
Which... I will say, before the stream started, Chris agreed with me that a lot of the later combat mechanics in Kingdom Hearts 2 are not very well explained. There's like four different limit form, drive form, master things, and it just gets
Drives are what's confusing you? Homie.
It's like, I still barely understand them. Anyways.
I don't want to do this, but I have to. Ian, what do you think of the Thousand Heartless battle where you kill a Thousand Heartless and it's all in one thing?
I actually like that. I actually love that. That was really cool.
The tech behind that is fascinating. I highly recommend looking up a video about it. We're not going there. Tunic, talk about it.
Yeah.
Yeah, shut up, Will. This is Ian Hour. Tunic. It's...
Zach told me about that.
The best world in the game.
Tunic is basically that Fox Zelda indie game, Zelda-like indie game that you've been seeing for years. It finally came out. A lot of people are talking a lot about it. There were people who were like, it's great how they don't hold your hand. You can really do like some sequence breaking in terms of they don't force you to go specific ways. And I was like, this sounds interesting. I'm not sure if I'm really into it, though. And then I found out it was on Game Pass. So I was like, cool. Mm. So I played like the first hour and a half of it the other day. A little underwhelming, to be honest with you.
That's what I've heard. Yeah.
But people are really, really hyping it up. But honestly, like, it does have some cool level design, and it definitely has a lot of polish on it and a cool graphical style. But the combat doesn't feel that great. It's almost borrowing too heavily from Soulsborne, where it's just like, here's an area, here's a bonfire. You lose something when you die, but you can go back and pick it up. And like, but the combat doesn't feel as good as a Soulsborne. And it's just like, that's my fat cat.
If Tunic isn't scratching that itch for you, I highly recommend, also on Games Pass, Unsighted.
I'll have to try that.
It was like my number five game of the year last year. It's fucking incredible.
The Tunic stuff.
I was just gonna say, I don't think Tunic is a bad game. If you're into that, maybe you'll love it. There's plenty of people who love it. I just was not as wowed by it as I thought it would be.
I was just gonna say, the Tunic stuff, at least like all that stuff you've mentioned, I've heard from people's like either they're hot and cold on it. I think the people love is like the NES like fake hieroglyphic hieroglyphic language and like puzzle mm-hmm. system and stuff. But I've also heard like Vinny was saying he likes that stuff, but he doesn't like solving it. He likes looking up other people's solutions to it because it's like Fez interesting. Like you yeah. would never spend the time to figure it out, but other people have.
Yeah, it's one of those where it's like it's I see the effort and it's a really 8 out of 10 effort, but it's not enough for me to fall in love with it and get sucked into it.
Zach, you're correct. Ian will hate Unsighted wrongly.
I'm gonna play it now. I'm ruin it for you, Chris.
Yeah, but I load it up right now.
I'm just kidding.
I can't wait for Ian to come back and say, I hated all the characters. They were too diverse. Why aren't they all white and straight?
Guys, man, I wish I could tell you about the match I had tonight in Nebulous. It was so good.
Wait, are you playing against other people?
Wait, this is a game I have to play against other humans?
You can, but I'm not even there yet. I'm not even there yet. It has a very thin skirmish mode because it's getting its early access, but I don't feel like I'm good enough yet to do that. But at some point I'm going to hop online, but even just like the hunt and you're just like, oh, he's over here. I'm going to distract him over here. Oh, what's going on? All of a sudden you got to roll. I will just say one final thing. It does a very good job. Like I had a 30-minute match. I didn't spot an enemy ship until 25 minutes in.
Wow.
Which is a little longer than usual, but it was also like very tense and plotting because I'm like, maybe I'll go this direction. Okay, maybe I need to check behind here, but you're not moving that fast. But then all of a sudden, like, boom, radar contact. Oh, shit, I'm being jammed. Oh, no, they've got 20 missiles at me. I hope my point defense is okay. And you're just all of a sudden, like, the combat just, boom, kicks off. Like, it almost like,
that,
it's almost
that,
like a tick.
Like, you said 25 minutes of not seeing someone. That sounds miserable. But, like, the way you describe it, it does sound pretty cool.
Yeah,
I'm not gonna play it. Not gonna touch this fucking game.
It's almost like Tarantino, where he does that thing now, where it's like we're gonna have a long, quiet scene, and then boom, it kicks into high gear, and there's like 60 seconds of like insane action. It's almost like that, and it feels so good. The payoff.
I don't know if this has been done, but I want a multiplayer game of exactly what you're describing. But when you make radar contact, your like view screen becomes their captain's room, and they're like, "You scum, I will destroy," like Star Trek, and you get to like yell at each other like funny. That.
It's like you want like Nebulous Fleet Command presented by Sid Meier's Civilization.
But that would just devolve into like, "I banged your mom. I'm gonna destroy you."
Wait, now you're describing Warhammer.
That sounds actually pretty good. I was thinking about getting it. But it is a steep $20.
I'll just let you borrow my copy. I wish I could do that with my Steam library. Just let you borrow my copy.
You can do the family thing. That's complicated and no one knows.
It's illegal,
Chris, you idiot. Actually, we have to redo that because I reinstalled Windows.
Oh, okay.
So come
and then
over,
you can
please.
Play. And then you can buy a copy so we can do multiplayer.
Yeah, totally. Chris, you don't have anything to talk about, right?
No video games. I don't play them. Elden Ring, we're not talking about it because we're talking about it. Go ahead. Fine, whatever you want.
I don't mean to be rude, but this list, I just want to hear about Kirby. So let's hear. This is the new Kirby you're talking about.
Hold on. I have bits prepared, Ian.
Oh, great. Oh,
Jesus Christ.
The bit train arrived at the station, everybody.
Elden Ring, we're not talking about Elden Ring. I've been playing this. I said earlier, game talked about the death. No, fuck, I'm not going to tell you anything new about Elden Ring. Sifu, I might. Hey guys, it is March 31st, and Sifu is my game of the year. I know.
Thanks for tuning in.
I'm as shocked as you are.
This game looked great. I've heard the difficulty is just obscene and offensive.
Oh, I don't. I mean, I don't agree with that. But I also play a lot of fighting games and enjoy games that have.
Oh, got you. So it is obscene and offensive. Gotcha. Fuck off. Yep.
I enjoy repetitive fighting. It's a thing I enjoy in video games. I hate the term. Like, this is a love letter to film or whatever the fuck. This is a genuine like love letter homage to kung fu movies and. God, is it so fucking well done. Like, the old boy hallway sequence in the first level, there's the raid set up in another level. All that stuff is handled so well. And like, I'm kind of getting over roguelikes in general. I'm just kind of like, all right, I get it. Every game is a fucking roguelike nowadays. The age mechanic, though, is really fucking interesting and really fun. And it is, like, it is a cool way of making me decide, is this even worth continuing? Or should I restart to try to do it more efficiently? And like the way that you bank like your age if you complete a level also is very cool. I I mean, I hope a game comes along and not knocks us out of my number one spot for the year. But like as of now, like Sifu is just fucking incredible. Soundtrack is also very good. It could use more variety because like most levels have like one song that evolves through the level. I kind of wish like some had like 2 to 3 songs that did that. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about motherfucking Kirby.
This is the new Kirby, right?
This is the new Kirby, baby. This is that fresh mouthful mode everybody's talking about. There's been a lot of like bullshit discourse about how this game is too easy. And to everyone that says that, I say this game is for fucking children. You just played Elden Ring. Shut up.
Nintendo games, they're about an experience, not a challenge. Come on.
Yeah. I mean, like, I always talk about the stupid Miyamoto thing where it's like every game could be their first, so treat it like it is. But like this is a great game to like give to a child and be like, here, go do the Kirby.
Your child, play Kirby.
And damn it, you're going to play Kirby and you're going to eat those fucking
whatever the woofles are called. Maybe your mother will come
home. I'm liking this game better than Elden Ring.
Hell yeah, man, I should get this game. I was on the fence, but man, I feel like I need to get this.
And like, is it a better game than Elden Ring? God, no. It's a fucking Kirby game. You run, you jump, you slap, you suck. But it is just a fucking video game. I sit down, I run, jump, suck. Like, I just take power, I throw boomerang. It's great. It's simple. It's all I fucking need. It's bright. The enemies are cute. Kirby dances around. The Waddledees are happy to be there. It's a fucking video game.
Love it.
And sometimes all you fucking need is an adorable Nintendo video game. And I don't need 97 hours. I need 10.
You just need run, jump, suck. That's all you
run,
need.
Run, jump, suck, baby.
It's
great.
On a pillow.
It's great. The way they do, like, there's bonus Waddledees if you want to go get them, but you don't have to, is really well done. Upgrading powers is cool. The soundtrack is a Nintendo soundtrack, so of course it's good. The boss fights are range from nothing to pretty damn good. You sit down, and it's just a pleasant experience for however long you play it. Fucking great. Kirby.
That's nice.
These two are super fast because you don't give a shit about them. Guilty Gear, the fight game, the Hitman punch game. You kick, you punch, you throw fireball. Testament, the new character came out. Very fun. This game is one of the better balanced fighters in a long time. I just love it. It's also one of the horniest games that exists. Jesus fucking Christ. Man, nobody... Guilty. Like, yeah, Daisuke, the director, he's just like... He's just horny on main and loves it. Like if I could get him and Yoko Taro to co-direct a game, like I'd be done. I'd be
just be a woman's breast. That would be the whole game.
Just three.
Yeah, the breast you hear is about, in a skirt as well.
they added a model viewer in the latest patch, and like, you can put down characters and like move them or whatever. People were getting their PlayStation accounts banned for like sharing the screenshots of Baikon's boobs too close because the algorithm recognized them as genuine human titties.
Oh, wow. Nice.
Which is awesome. That's game design. Guilty Gear Strive.
Okay, got it. Just add that to my bank.
And then Apex Legends, they added that 6v6 mode, or they added it back. It was there for a while. Hey, it's fucking good. Hey, shocking. Titanfall works as a fucking like non-battle royale shooter. Who'd have fucking thunk it? Somewhere, some person at EA is like, can't cut, pull the plug. Apex gotta go. Not making any money. I don't care if they're the most popular game in the world. That's all I got. Oh, I did play the Fortnite no building mode. Man, that game's better when I don't have to build.
Yeah, I bet.
I thought about installing Fortnite.
It's still bad though. I
need like a crappy
shooting. Cartoony.
You know what I've almost settled on, Ian? As I almost thought about installing Escape from Tarkov as like a game to start playing.
You don't want to do that. The Hunt Showdown, I feel like, is a good middle ground that I should really try.
We should try that. That'd be a good stream.
Is that the one where you're like doing a heist?
No, you're doing like
it's
exorcism.
It's like it's like swamp voodoo redneck shooter kinda, but like zone-esque. So, you know, you go in the zone, you've got PvE, you got PvP, and you're trying to extract.
Yeah, you're trying to
heard really good things about it.
Like you're finding all these clues to then find the final like spirit, and then you have to banish the spirit and then make it off the map. Like before
yeah,
the
but
other
it's still a shooter though.
Yeah.
It's still it's like a battle royale-esque zone shooter.
And I think the
it's
other
like
one
hit game Evolve, you guys remember Evolve?
Oh god. The game I should pitch now that half the Subpixel, half the save data crew is in our chat right now, is we should do the Midnight Ghost Hunt, just hit early access, which is the I think it's 4v4 prop hunt ghost exorcist.
Oh yes, I did see game. I didn't know that was its name. I did see that though.
That I've been in the like alpha fun. For years and I've never played it. I've just been in it and like it always updates on Steam. But you
hey, everybody
like,
in chat, doesn't that box behind Ian look like pasta?
Objects and everything. It does look like pasta.
This one? Right here?
yeah, that's the one.
Anyways, that's all the games we have been playing, which means it's
time
to move
on. Oh my god,
to
we're
the
done.
News section, which
we're
means I'm gonna hit this button. It's gonna play the news theme.
Here's the news. We're talking about news. It's gaming news. What's up, news?
What's up,
news? Is that
news?
Getting more compressed? Am I insane?
It's just I'm just putting
filters on it the entire time.
Oh god.
And
hated
just
that.
Making it even worse.
Because it did sound like it said what's up dudes.
What's up dudes?
Welcome to the news time with the dudes.
Yeah, it's his bar rendition. What's up dudes? Folks. Oh man, David's saying he has decent vision, it's Pikachu. Nailed it.
I don't have decent vision.
You're both also wearing glasses right now.
Yes,
so.
I have a severe case of strabismus.
I knew what it
Fuck
was.
Off.
I'm just agreeing
eye,
that it looks like a box of pasta.
Basically doesn't work.
Well, get a new this eye, Chris.
Can I ask real quick? We have Chrono Cross, the Mythical Dreamers edition in the news, but yeah. This article is from February 9th. But did something happen with this recently?
Yes, so the original article said or the original press release said they were going to have you the ability to switch between the original music and the new remastered remixed music, and now they have come out and tweeted that only the new music is in it and you can no longer go back to the old music.
Congratulations, there is no reason to play this game because the only redeeming quality about Chrono Cross is that the soundtrack fucking rules. It is a better soundtrack than Chrono Trigger. Fight me, internet. But the game sucks, so it doesn't suck. It's just an incredible step down from Chrono Trigger.
Okay. So I literally Googled Chrono Cross and pasted the first link in here so I would remember, which is why
gotcha.
It probably has
okay.
nothing to do with it.
Yeah, that's a little disappointing because I feel like the standard for remasters now is higher in a good way. You know, yeah. It's like you can't just remaster the whole thing. You've got to pay homage to the original, whether that is like doing a tasteful remaster or including some of the stuff from the original if you're going to add new stuff. And
Nintendo begs to differ. We'll upscale it maybe, and it's the best you're going to get.
We'll upscale it and play it on a bad emulator for
you.
That's what you'll get. Yeah. But, you know, between like Shadow of the Colossus and Halo Master Chief Collection and all that stuff, it's not enough just to like literally remaster and put it out there in morning. You got to put a little bit of love into it. So it's a shame to see them take a step back like that.
Yeah, it's kind of sucks. I'm glad you brought that up first, though, because that was by far the most interesting story of the week. Where do we even begin? I didn't put this in any
Let's
sort
start
of
with
order.
The top one. When you said the most important thing this week, I feel like the top one is.
Yeah, I would agree.
Yeah.
They announced the new PlayStation Plus subscription. By not calling it something different and confusing everyone.
Hey, Will, how much money does this fucking thing cost?
I mean, what do you want? Do you want shit, or shittier?
The first two are the same.
The first two are the same, but what you get to stream one of them.
I will say they did do something different, which is unlike Xbox, which Xbox Live Gold is still a thing. This is the new PlayStation Plus. So if you buy PlayStation Plus Essential, it's not a separate product from the typical PlayStation Plus. Because I actually got an email as a PlayStation Plus subscriber. They were like, hey, we're rolling you into Essential because this is the new thing. So even though I'm not a big fan of three separate tiers, I do at least appreciate that they're rolling into the new service versus Xbox trying to like kill off Gold with a massive price hike that everybody hates, but they don't have the balls to actually kill it off as a service. So... But other than that, yeah, I think, so, man, what do you guys feel? Thoughts on this?
Well, you want to, I can run through this quick for people who might not know. So there's PlayStation Plus Essential, same thing, $60 a year, same perks, the free games, the cloud storage, multiplayer, and discounts during sales. Then the next tier up will be PlayStation Plus Extra. It'll be $15 a month, US, $100 per year, features up to 400 PS4 and PS5 games. Now, this is the one thing. Is this entire thing separate from that PlayStation collection? Or is that getting rolled into...
This is separate from the PlayStation collection and will be replacing PlayStation Now.
Copy. Okay.
Which is a terrible system. PS Now is awful. Yes.
So Sony subscription extra tier is a bit vague. So yeah, it's just adding those things from the previous tier plus... 400 PS4 and PS5 game. And yes, and you're saying PlayStation Plus and PlayStation Now are discontinued in June, and PlayStation Now subscribers will be converted to the PS Plus Extra, and the PlayStation Plus will be converted to the Essential. And then the most expensive tier is the PlayStation Plus Premium, which will be $18 a year, and that has everything I've mentioned already, plus up to 340 additional games, including PlayStation back catalog with the original PlayStation, PS2, PS3, and PSP games available to play. Although PS3, a console that came out in 2007 by the company that is putting this out, are only available to stream through the cloud and cannot be downloaded at all. And you have to stream them because they can't figure out their own fucking technology.
I will say, just a caveat here, again, the wording was a little vague, but the PS2, PS1, PSP games, not all of those are downloadable. They did not definitively say, so some of those will be cloud streaming as well, which was kind of the big problem with PlayStation Now, was that
if you want to play the Metal Gear Collection from PlayStation 3, you can stream a version of an emulated game. Yeah. I'm sure that'll go great.
Yep. So I was kind of back and forth with this. I'm glad Sony is finally hopping on the game subscription because that's the way of the future. And honestly, it's better for consumers. I was a little disappointed by some of the offering, you know, making it confusing with tiers and then also locking the backwards compatibility beyond the PS4 behind the premium tier and having a lot of cloud streaming. But there's something that got me back on board, folks. Something that this service has that Games Pass does not, which is an annual discount. Game Pass Ultimate is $15 a month. There's no annual discount, but this PlayStation Premium, aka the $18 per month tier, is $120 per year if you subscribe annually, which means it's really only $10 a month. And that's a pretty good deal for what you're getting on that compared to Game Pass.
I think
that at least makes it equal, even though you can't get the first party day one like you do with Game Pass.
Yeah, I don't know about equal, Chief, but it makes it better.
I will
first
say,
party,
I buy my
first
Game
party
Pass.
Day one is pretty good.
It's pretty good, but also, you know, a third cheaper.
Yeah. But yeah. I think, yeah, I there are ways to get.
Hey, third cheaper is only one game, not even. So
true.
That's a fair point.
You gotta buy it day
there
one.
Are,
on
it's okay. The PlayStation exclusives aren't that good anyway, so I'll just wait for them to come to the library.
Jesus. Yeah. I was going to say there are cheaper ways to buy Xbox Game Pass, which is what most people do and what I do, but I think you have a good point in the fact that it's Sony directly offering the cheaper way to buy it.
Yes.
Rather than a retail.
I don't have to go get like a Taco Bell fucking Gordita Crunch and then I get a dollar gets me a month of Xbox Game Pass, whatever the fuck it is.
Yeah. I do that every day.
So I was planning on just doing month to month. Like, for example, Returnal is going to be on the service day one. I've been thinking about playing Returnal. I didn't really want to buy it, but pay $15 for that first month, play Returnal, and then cancel the service. But the fact that I can just pay $120 and basically get this service for the year and have that library going, I think they have something competitive here. When I first looked at it, when the rumors were coming out, it really didn't sound that competitive.
Yeah, I think I'll probably do it too, just to have it, because that also affords a ton of opportunities to be like, hey, person who also has it, we can just play these games together, you know. Even if they have the sort of basic thing there. And I'm also genuinely interested to see what games they are in all of those categories.
Yeah. So honestly, my big fear, and I think this is going to be true, is that 90% of these games outside of the PlayStation exclusives are going to be the same games you see on Game Pass. So I'm worried that the library overlap is going to be huge. That's my concern.
It's a huge concern, Ian. My concern is that Ian, Chris has pasted a article in here about trademark.
I know you were talking about the most important topics. I see this was not here. That must have been a mistake, right?
Yeah, that's so weird. My computer. anyways, folks, Zelda Breath of the Wild 2 has been delayed.
No, Knack 3! Come on, it's hilarious!
Nobody cares about Knack.
No, they're going to make Knack 3. This fucking stupid-ass company is going to make Knack 3.
Yeah,
because
Mark Cerny needs his Knack.
Guess what he wants.
Each of the Knack games, it's harboring his child's consciousness that he lost in the war. And so he has to upload the consciousness as they develop.
What war?
The cyber war, Chris.
Console war. Console wars. I lost a child to the console wars.
If Phil Spencer gets Voodoo Vince, then I think Cerny gets to make Knack every now and then. Come on.
If Phil Spencer gets his lasers and t-shirts.
Yeah.
Yes, Breath of the Wild has been pushed to spring 2023. There was a tweet out from Trigon Nintendo. Glasses. Oh God, shut up!
Try our glasses, playing stuff, videos. You know.
Ugh. I want to. Why can't? Why isn't? Oh, it's saying Eiji Onuma.
I don't know what you're doing over there.
No. I wanted to make sure I pronounce his name right. Eiji Onuma.
Eiji Aonuma.
With his cute little haircut that people were making fun of, but I thought it was adorable, he's like a little schoolboy, to announce that they were delaying it because they needed more time and they wanted to make it perfect, and that they've been playing Elden Ring a lot and they want to incorporate some of that stuff. And there was a tiny bit of new footage showing off the new Master Sword and a symbol on the robot hand of Link that people are trying to decipher. Anyways, it's delayed. I think we all saw this coming.
Yes. Well, I don't want to say I didn't. I didn't, just because
it was
Nintendo,
a possibility, I should say.
Yeah, possibility. But I just mean because Nintendo, they do a lot of like shadow drops, or like, hey, here's this brand new game, comes out in 4 months. You know, we knew about this game beforehand, so it's hard to kind of pin down outside of rumors where Nintendo actually is with the game. But I'm okay with this, because my number one concern with Breath of the Wild 2 that I used to have, that isn't really concerning me anymore, that it was just like, hey, we're just going to do the exact same map and add a little bit more content in it to be able to slap a 2 on it. And this sounds like they are taking the time, and what they're showing off, that they are actually making a freaking new game here. And that gets me very excited. So you take as much time as you need.
I'm fine. Delay this game as long as you need. That's fine. But please, for the love of Christ, the next time you mention this fucking game, give it a fucking title. I am so sick of the phrasing "the sequel to Breath of the Wild." Just fucking name it. I don't like, shut the fuck.
That's
up.
The name. That's the name.
I hope so. At this point, they pull a Project Triangle strategy and just drop the project.
It's like, how?
No, the real name is the sequel project to Breath of the Wild.
Ooh.
But it's like, are they like not gonna say like? Because they said they weren't going to reveal the name because it would spoil what the game's about.
It's a spoiler.
About, which I get.
It's Skyward Sword.
But you're going to have to say it eventually, and people are going to speculate the same amount between when you announce it and when the game comes out. It'll be the same compounded amount of speculation
because you're not feeding them anything.
You're in control.
It'll say the sequel to Breath of the Wild on the box art. And then you know how games love, like, you know, like the Assassin's Creed 3, like 2 hour delayed title card.
Yeah.
Title card hits after the last boss fight. and then you have to like
scratch the new title onto the front of the case.
It's actually a scratch and sniff case.
You have to lick the cartridge title on, and it tastes awful.
Oh god,
tastes like glue.
So yeah, I'm excited for Breath of the Wild 2. Sorry, the sequel to Breath of the Wild.
Thank you.
Sorry, the sequel to Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild.
Can I just say something really, really quick? Honestly, this is not a joke. We've joked about this before, but legitimately, kudos to them for not blaming COVID for the delay, because it feels like 99% of delays are still blaming COVID and the pandemic when that window has sailed, folks. Yeah,
and what do you mean? We're only 3.5 years in. I got like 6 more years of blaming COVID, baby.
We're not used to working at home yet.
No, kudos for not blaming the war in Ukraine, because it's...
What?
I'm kidding. I'm joking.
Yeah, Link won't work when there's when
I mean,
Ukraine
we all know
is
Japan
in
is in the Ukraine.
Ganon, Putin, you know, there's too much of a similarity there.
Oh. Moving on. This is just a quick one I saw this morning. Warhammer 40K Dark Tide coming out September 13th. I'm excited for this game. Yes. I like Vermintide. I like Vermintide 2. I always wanted a ever since Vermintide 1, like, hey, put 40K in this and let us do that. So this looks like fun. I thought it was Game Pass day one. I couldn't find anywhere saying that.
I think it is.
Okay, because I was trying to check and it was quick before the stream, but I didn't actually find anything.
I was interested in this game, but then they announced Space Marine 2, so I'm just horny for Space Marine 2.
I want to try Space Marine 1. I've never played it.
I will happily join you for a stream series of that, because that game, that is like that game
costume.
No, it's single player, but like I'll just like co-pilot. That game fucking rules.
Maybe I'll set that up. I'm just going to skip down to the big news that came out today.
Look here. Yeah, it's great.
E3 2022.
Oh, wow. I thought you were going to pull a zigzag on us and talk about Dwarf Fortress, you fucking bastard.
Oh, I'm saving that one for the special hour.
What did we yell during that stream? Zigzagoon?
Yes.
Zigzagoon!
You misheard it and things happened, and thankfully that stream never picked up what you said. No, you said it, but you didn't mean to say it.
I know.
You didn't know.
And then you guys
were
looking at me weird, and I was like, wait, oh no. Anyways, E3 2022 has been canceled, digital included. There's just nothing happening. I'm gonna dig into this real quick. Was this officially confirmed, or is this heavy rumors?
There's a quote from the ESA confirmed. I'll have you know, I know this is confirmed because we were waiting to run a graphic and we didn't want to use the word report in the graphic. So we were waiting for it to get confirmed because IGN got it confirmed, but we still didn't get it confirmed.
But this is not, people are acting like E3 is dead, but now that I'm reading this press release, they very clearly say we're coming back in 2023.
It was the half an hour before the ESA said anything, people were saying it was dead. That's why there's like so much of that content.
Yeah, because I just want to say, I know E3 has its problems, but going through a console launch without E3 as like a tentpole for people to rally around and have actual meaningful announcements in that E3 week was hellish. It was like what? Wasn't it like 6 weeks before launch when we finally got the price of the consoles? It was insane. And it's because there was no like Super Bowl type event for the whole industry to get together and drop big announcements. And that's what E3 is. It's a sort of organization.
But Jeff Keighley,
I genuinely think that like it won't matter. Next console cycle, they won't feel the need to say anything at E3 because they didn't. And guess what? The consoles sold more than ever. So like it doesn't matter.
Yeah, but I think what E3 really did was it created such like a news press hype within that week. So if Sony says something big, they dominate the news cycle. So it's one of those things where it's like we can't let the other guy dominate this small news cycle. So it being spread out over the summer made it suck.
But I think like they've proven since then that like we can just do a state of play whenever the hell we want and dominate the news cycle.
I mean, you say that, but Sony's in a really bad state right now, and that's it's because
I think Nintendo has got that more down, where it's like they can do whatever they want. You'll watch the direct. I think like if Sony and Xbox, they do it less, but if they were to like start using that model, I don't think it'd be good, but I think it would really hurt E3's like whole everything. Yeah, yeah. And I'm like, I just worry that it could get worse. We mentioned this in the Save the Slack before. I was like, I don't really know what, like, I don't think E3 is vital anymore. I mean, obviously I want gaming news and I would like it in one chunk, but I don't think like it's, I don't think it's necessary to the industry. And I think like that if they are coming back next year, I personally don't necessarily know that they are. But if they are, I really hope that they like recalibrate on what makes E3 and maybe like push it more towards how PAX is, like more content around like creators. Maybe like add some like here come, we're also doing like a Valorant big tournament that we're having like a look, they gotta put butts in seats and that's the most popular game in the world, so
get the influencers
and they've been trying to do that, and they've been trying to be a little bit more like PAX where it's like, hey, let's bring the consumers in, make this unique. They've just been doing a terrible job at it, so I feel like exactly,
so if you're
taking
a fucking year off, get it right.
Like E3 could be phenomenal. You know, you bring in the consumers, but you actually have those exclusives, you know, like they used to do where it's like, hey, you want to play Breath of the Wild like early? Yo, come in, stand in this line for a while and you'll get to play Breath of the Wild early. You know, open it to the public, get that kind of fandom coming in, bring the exclusives, the big announcements. You can merge PAX and E3 and come up with something great in the future. These people have just been doing a terrible job at trying to do that for years now.
Well, Godspeed, E3. We hope to see you in 2023, back in LA. We'll all be there. We'll high five. We'll go inside and wait.
I want to be Pixel E3.
I want to be where the people are. I want to be. This next story I thought was really neat. So I actually didn't know this. It's a Russian studio that made the hit 2021 game Loop Hero, a game that Ian could not.
Yeah,
understand.
I also didn't know that it was Russian.
I just understood it. I just didn't like it.
Yeah, sure.
And I wasn't going to voice my opinion until you called me out on it. So this is on you, Will. Eggs on your face.
I love it.
Sunny side up.
Oh, my God. So they put out a statement basically saying, hey, it's impossible to get our game right now. So just pirate it. Like, torrents
and
are cool.
And that rules.
Pirate our game. Do awesome. It. And so everyone's like, Devolver, they're saying pirate the game. And then Devolver said, Devolver Digital fully supports Four Quarters as they navigate the incredible difficult period. We've been communicating with them, the team, to help whenever possible, and we've alerted the statement ahead of time, which we 100% back. It's like, I mean, like, yes, but also Devolver's just great. Like,
Yeah, Devolver's great.
But what do you mean? Yeah. A company wouldn't say this unless it was their last resort. Like, if you want to play our game, torrent it.
And, like, the company's saying like, ah, fuck, it sucks. And then Devolver says, don't worry, get out there. Fuck bitches, get money. They're like, we're not getting any money. Well, fuck bitches anyway.
Make it suck less.
Godspeed.
And then the... I'm getting so emotional. The final story here, they've shown off some of the character sheets for the new Dwarf Fortress.
Oh,
and boys, they look so fucking good. I'm so excited. Good. The other thing, like, Dwarf Fortress is an infuriating game because it is
nice,
incredible. Push it. It's deep. It is so disorganized. And this
it still works somehow. It's still amazing somehow.
It is. This amount of organization is incredible. And Tarn talks about it a little bit at the bottom, but like, there's a tab here that just says memories, and it sorts all the memories by year and season. Versus in Dwarf Fortress now, you have to just check their memories during a season to get the like drip feed of content that is like amassed in this game. So like, just the improvement of just like exploring your dwarves and just like seeing all this cool stuff. Like, even if you don't want to play the game, like, people run Dwarf Fortress just to get the histories. Like, some of that stuff is so incredible. Like what it comes up with and what happens.
Hell
that
yeah.
It's super neat. So I'm excited for this. It's supposed to come out this year. They want to push it, or they're pushing for November. And I just think it looks gorgeous. And this game with the UI is what it has needed for so long, that it's just exciting to see.
I was doing shtick with the baseball.
I saw
my hitbox and stuff like that. But, I'm gonna play the fuck out of this when it comes out.
Right?
Yeah. It's like, yeah, the only thing keeping me from giving a shit about Dwarf Fortress is that it looks like Dwarf Fortress. So with a UI,
right?
Daddy horny.
Like
and controls and yeah. Decent controls.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, oh, I didn't know they were doing Dwarf Fortress. That makes me even happier.
Oh yeah, it's got mouse controls. It's got UI. It's got new. It's got an official tile set.
It's got UI. This one has UX too. That's new for your
Fortress. Does. Yeah, that's real.
I'm not joking. Yeah, that's real.
You'll be able to install it through something rather than just.
Oh my god! How many different move commands are there though?
Yeah. Honestly,
it's
Ian,
like Z and Y.
Honestly, Ian, weirdly enough, I have a feeling there's going to be hundreds.
I will say the hardest thing to understand about Dwarf Fortress is, and you'll probably Dwarf get Fortress. Here if it comes out this year, is how. Floors and digging works. Like you can dig a little bit into the floor, but to go all the way through the floor you have to do a staircase, but then to come back up through the floor you need to do a double stair. Like it's like some weird stuff that makes sense when you think about it, but explaining it to someone is like, because you don't want when you want to make a floor you don't want to dig through the floor. Like, that's the difference.
You want to dig to the floor.
Right, yeah. Exactly. So it's like a weird thing that you don't think about when everything's flat and you're when other games just simplify it, which is pretty interesting.
How old is this fucking game?
2006, I think, is really? When it first launched.
God, that's crazy.
It's technically the second Slaves of Amok game. Amok game. But yeah,
I feel like I should stream Nebula's Fleet Command at some
you
point.
You should.
It's a lot of fun.
I would watch you play that. Yeah. That's going to be it. I don't want to talk about Blue Box and Abandon, even though it's canceled. Or
What about the Sonic Frontier Limited Edition?
Oh, we moved that to next week.
Yeah, okay. I realized next week we should really do like a best of April Fools, because this is only out now because it's April 1st in Japan already.
I want to get ahead of this. I detest April Fool's jokes by companies.
Tomorrow.
I must say, in video game ones, I find particularly annoying because a lot of them are really cringy. This one's actually funny, so I'll give it to them.
I would like your feedback. I think I made a pretty decent one. So, you let me know tomorrow, sir, if you approve of my April Fools. Folks, thank you so much for tuning in. I would like to thank David, Zach, Elise, and OP for tuning in the chat. Thank you for being there. Double staircase all the way across the sky. Ian has been here. It's good to have you. I'm so sad that Kingdom Hearts is coming to a close, but you're not coming to a close in my heart. You're blossoming like a nubile infant.
I could be firing rail guns right now instead of going through this god-awful
I could be railing fire guns right now. Chris, thank you for being here as well. It's been a while. I'm glad you skipped that awful Around the Monitor show. It's terrible and nobody likes it. Have me on more streams.
please
get me out of here. Folks, Saturday, 8 p.m., like I mentioned, Kingdom Hearts 2. I will be there, probably drunk, in chat, making sure people aren't there talking about ball sniffing. If you are, that's okay, but when it gets a little racist,
sniffing.
I'm gonna ban you.
Oh no!
Or actually, I just timed them out and they never came back, so that worked
out too.
That
was too real to be a joke.
Too real! Folks, thank you so much for tuning in, and we will see you all next week.